to me. is not in what I own, not in the strength of flesh and bone, but in the costly wounds of love at the cross. My worth is not in skill or name, in win or lose, in pride or shame, but in the blood of Christ that flowed at the cross. I rejoice in my Redeemer, greatest treasure, wellspring of my soul. I will trust in him no other. My soul is satisfied in him alone.
As summer flies, we fade and die. Fame, youth, and beauty. Eternal calls to us at the cross. I will not boast in wealth or mine, or human wisdom's fleeting light, but I will boast in knowing Christ at the cross. In my Redeemer, greatest treasure, wellspring of my soul. I will trust in him no other. My soul is satisfied in him alone.
Treasure, wellspring of my soul. O Israel, the people of the Lord, be still and know that He is God. Love the Lord your God with the fullness of your heart, with all your mind, your strength and soul. We draw near through Christ who saves us. We draw near to the throne of grace. Hear, O Israel, the people of the Lord. Come lift your voice and praise your King. Let's stand together. We have come to praise the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, and to give Him praise today, for He is a great God. Let's sing together.
The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, let all the earth rejoice. He wraps Himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at His voice, and trembles at His voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great is our God. And age to age He stands, and time is in His hands. Beginning and the end, the Godhead three in one, Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great.
Seated for just a moment this morning, if you would.
Well, good morning and welcome to Parker Bible Church's 25th anniversary celebration. We are so excited. We're looking forward to this time of celebration this morning. Those of you that have come from out of town, we're so thankful. It's so good to see old faces and to reconnect. And so we pray for this morning. We hope that everyone just enjoys this time and we celebrate the Lord. You know, when I was thinking about this, that this church began September 1994, I thought to myself, I wonder what was going on in the world in 1994. And there are a few things I thought we could highlight from 1994 that were going on. Number one, the president was Bill Clinton. That seems like a long time ago. Baseball was on strike. For Nebraska fans out there, this is a highlight, not like yesterday, but Nebraska went 13-0, was the national champion. Yeah. It was a while ago. We remember the old, on TV, watching the white Bronco police chase. You guys remember that? Was O.J. Simpson. That was 1994. The Lion King came out, Forrest Gump, the founding of Yahoo and Amazon in 1994. For you youngsters out there, the original PlayStation came out in 1994. One of the first web browsers, Netscape Mosaic for the public, came out. I mean, think about that. You could get just a few years after that, you could get a Gateway Solo laptop for a mere $4,149. And the hard drive was 20 to 42 megabytes. Cell phones were around $1,000, no different than today, but your plan... Your plan was $20 to $30 a month, plus you had to pay 45 to 75 cents a minute to talk. So gas was $1.11. Wish we could bring that back. And then, of course, Parker Bible Church was planted. I would say probably for us, one of the most significant out of all those things, the Lord decided in his mercy, in his kindness to plant this church, to lead the group to plant here in Parker, Colorado. And, you know, now we're almost three centuries later, decades. 20. Yeah. Kirk, you're not that old. And then we see at least a couple generations that the church has ministered to, kids that now have kids and that are here back visiting. The Lord has been so faithful. And so we just look forward to this time of worship, celebration, and then fellowship afterwards. And so we're just really glad that you're here. Well, as we begin, why don't we pray, and then we'll take a moment and greet one another in the name of the Lord. Father, we thank you so much that you always bless beyond what we deserve, and that you are always causing us to stand in awe and be amazed at how you work and how you have carried and sustained this body of believers for 25 years is amazing. Through many different changes in our culture, and as we have stayed faithful to the preaching of your word, you have stayed faithful to preserving your church. And so, Father, we thank you for that today. We celebrate Jesus, our Savior, this morning. We look forward to this time. Lord, we just pray that you'd be glorified, you'd be honored, and that this fellowship would be sweet today. And we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, why don't we stand and take a moment? Let's greet one another in the name of the Lord.
Well, if you would find your place, move, find your place back, and just be seated for just a moment, if you would, this morning.
Eternal. Wow, what a day this is. The last 25 years has been quite a journey. It seems like it's gone by so quickly. It hasn't always been smooth. It's been up and down, and there have been all kinds of, you know, turns in the road and all that kind of thing, but God is gracious, and God is forever faithful. And so we are here today to rejoice and celebrate in all that God has done. He alone deserves all the glory. And he is the one, by his providence, who planted this church 25 years ago. He is the one who has carried us through the thick and thin. And so we're here today to rejoice and give him thanks. So that's what we're doing today. I thank you for being here this morning, and especially those who made extra effort to be here. We've received a number of cards and letters and really sweet things, and I won't take the time this morning to read all of those, but I appreciate those as well. But for those of you who have made an effort to be here just for this special day, I thank you so much. That just means much to all of us. I want to ask, if you are no longer attending Parker Bible Church, but you have been in the past, I want to ask all of you to stand. If you would stand, if you've been with us in the past, no longer now at PBC, stand. Thank you so much. Let's give these, appreciate that. Now, we also have other guests with us today, so we don't want to leave you out. We're glad that you are here with us today, and maybe you just came today. You had no idea this was going on, but we're delighted that you're with us today as well. Hope that you feel welcome and come back and worship with us again. Our service today is a little different. This is not what we typically do. We usually have two worship services and Bible study in between that. But our service today is going to be a little bit longer than usual. We're going to take this in two parts. We're going to have our normal worship elements first, and then we're going to celebrate and remember toward the end of our time this morning. Of course, it's all worship because we're all glorifying God in this. But we're going to turn our hearts toward singing, praise to the Lord, the ministry of the word, and then we'll reflect back on all that God has done throughout the last 25 years. When I thought of the scripture passage that I wanted to highlight this morning, I immediately went to this passage in 2 Timothy chapter 4. So I encourage you to find 2 Timothy 4 in your Bible this morning. We use the New American Standard here usually for our readings, but I want us to read this section together, 2 Timothy 4, and if you would, to honor the word of the Lord, would you stand with me, and you follow along as we read it together. 2 Timothy 4, verse 1, I solemnly charge you in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who is to judge the living and the dead, and by his appearing and his kingdom, preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with great patience and instruction. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but wanting to have their ears tickled, they will accumulate for themselves teachers in accordance to their own desires, and will turn away their ears from the truth and will turn aside to myths. But you, be sober in all things, endure hardship, do the work of an evangelist, fulfill your ministry. Let's pray together. Father, we are grateful to you today. We are grateful for this body of believers. We are thankful for all those who have been a part in the last 25 years, at whatever point along the way. We thank you for those who've come to know Christ through this ministry. We thank you for those who have grown spiritually through your word. Lord, we thank you for the fellowship that we have developed over the years that goes beyond even now and will extend into eternity. And Lord, we thank you that this is really just kind of a small taste of heaven. This is what heaven's going to be like when we are one day around your throne, able to rejoice in our salvation and knowing that it's only by your grace and being able to praise you forever and enjoy each other's fellowship. Lord, what a rich thing that is. And it's a wonderful thing to just have a small taste of that today. So Lord, we thank you. We thank you for your provision. We thank you for your faithfulness. And Lord, we exalt your name today. This is not about any man. This is about you alone. And we give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Be seated.
Well, what a joy that we are singing of the faithfulness of our great God today, even as we celebrate 25 years together. So let's sing together.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever wilt be.
We sing his faithfulness. We praise him. We give him hallelujahs because he is worthy. Let's stand together as we continue to lift our voices together.
There's a hallelujah, an everlasting song, a never-ending anthem. We sing to you alone, resounding in the heavens and in our hearts today. How greatly we're forgiven, and how great will be your praise. And with this song I will rise for the honor of your name. From this breath to my last, then forever and a day, I'll pour out my heart, I'll pour out my soul, my greatest hallelujah. Alpha and Omega, beginning and the end, author of salvation, a father and a friend. You thunder and you whisper, your glory fills the skies. Worthy you are, worthy, let your name be lifted high. And with this song I will rise for the honor of your name. From this breath to my last, then forever and a day, day above them all, when we will stand in glory and see the face of God. Sing, holy, 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 holy is the Lord, and bring our hallelujahs, for you reign forevermore. We'll bring our hallelujahs, for you reign forevermore. And with this song I will rise for the honor of your name. From this breath to my last, then forever and a day, I'll pour out my heart, I'll pour out my soul, my greatest hallelujah. And we will sing hallelujah, forever sing hallelujah. Your people sing hallelujah, forever sing hallelujah. And we will sing hallelujah.
Let's pray. Father, again, as we think about your faithfulness over these 25 years, and as we come to this portion of worship where we give of tithes and offerings, we know that this is a time in which we give to you a lot more than our money, our income. But it's a great reminder for us to be all in for you and to give our time and our talent to you as well. We're thankful for those that you have led throughout the years to give generously here to sustain this body of believers. We thank you for your sustaining power. We pray now for today that you would continue to do that in our midst, that you would continue to instill generous hearts, Christ-likeness within us, that we might be kingdom-minded, that we might glorify you as your gospel is spread through the ministry of this church. And so, Father, we ask your blessing. We pray that Christ would be honored in this time, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Do you feel the world is broken? We do. Do you feel the shadows deepen? We do. But do you know that all the dark won't stop the light from getting through? We do. Do you wish that you could see it all made new? We do. Is all creation groaning? It is. Is a new creation coming? It is. Is the glory of the Lord to be the light within our midst? It is. Is it good that we remind ourselves of this? It is. Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave. He is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slain. Is he worthy? And honor and glory, is he worthy of this? He is. Does the Father truly love us? He does. Does the Spirit move among us? He does. And does Jesus, our Messiah, hold forever those he loves? He does. Does our God intend to dwell again with us? He does. Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave. He is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slave. From every people and tribe, every nation and tongue, he has made us a kingdom and priest to God to reign with the Son. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of this?
Well, amen. Yeah, you can applaud to that. I would agree on that. Amen. Thank you so much. Well, in the past 25 years, we have made a lot of mistakes. But there is one thing we have done right. Our commitment to the Word of God has been the preeminent priority from the very first day. And as we consider the history of Parker Bible Church, we are quick to acknowledge that in our human frailty, we have failed often. In fact, the seed for this church is found in my own failure. Several years ago, before Riverside Baptist Church South began, I made a horrible mistake. I became enamored with the church growth movement and began pursuing what was then called the seeker-friendly church. And I bought into the faulty notion that we must strive to build the church through human methodologies and clever marketing strategies. I got caught up in the trendy, popular philosophy of that day, and before long, I was in a co-pastorate with a friend of mine from seminary. And I won't go into the details of what happened, but when I came to the end of that experiment, I found myself ousted by my friend, but it turned out to be the best thing that could ever happen to me. As I was packing up my books to vacate my office the next day, the very first book off the shelf was John MacArthur's Rediscovering Expository Preaching. And God used that book to change my life and ministry in a radical way. Through that experience, I learned some very important lessons the hard way. I made a commitment before God that if He ever gave me another opportunity, I would be absolutely firm in my calling as an expositor of His Word. I made a sincere rededication of my life and ministry that I would be a faithful preacher of the Word of God and never veer from that moment on. And I made a vow to God that I would do nothing but systematically preach His Word. That experience also cured me of some faulty thinking. I came to the conclusion that it's not my job to grow the church. It's my job to preach God's word, and He has promised to grow His church. I hadn't realized it, but by embracing the pragmatic principles of the modern church growth movement, I had, in fact, usurped the role of the Holy Spirit. I had bought into the notion that the growth of the church depends on human methodologies. And I had unknowingly taken on a role that I was never intended to have. God's word declares, unless the Lord builds the church, they labor in vain who build it. It has never been my job to build this church. It is His church, and He has promised to build it. And from that very first day, He has done exactly that. And what we're celebrating today is 25 years of God's faithfulness. He has been with us through the sweet times and through the tough times. Over and over again, he has proven himself faithful. He has built his church, and he alone deserves the glory. But I learned another valuable lesson through that painful experience. I learned that the purpose for the church when it gathers is not primarily evangelism. The church growth movement, or the seeker-sensitive movement, or the pragmatic church movement, whatever you want to call it, has really gotten things turned around in regard for the purpose for the church when it gathers. In fact, biblically, there are two main purposes for the church when it gathers corporately: the worship of God and the edification of the saints. Evangelism is done as we go into the world. And of course, that's not to say that we should never proclaim the gospel message from the pulpit, but it really makes a huge difference in our approach and ministry philosophy when we understand that difference. Instead of dumbing down our services and making everything for unchurched Harry and Mary, we give the meat of God's word and deep theology to build up the saints for the work of ministry. We systematically feed believers through the diligent expository preaching of Scripture, and that equips the people of God for the work of ministry that he calls us to do, not only here, but in the world. Now, with these things firm in my heart, we were led through a series of factors to begin a new church here in Parker. These principles really became the foundation upon which we built this church by God's grace. And I am so grateful today for that small core of people who stood beside us to help launch the church in the beginning days, and many of them are here today. They were rock solid supporters. They worked hard to put everything in place and to do whatever was needed when we were in our infancy. And I am so grateful to them. I'm so grateful that on that very first Sunday, the first official service, September 11, 1994, we had 119 people that showed up. We never dropped below 100, and it was an amazing start, and it's all by God's grace. It's all because of him. But one of the first things that we needed in the new church was we needed a written ministry philosophy. We needed some tracks to run on, and so I wrote those before the church began, and they have not changed in 25 years. That is still what we use in our orientation class today. So as I thought about what I wanted to say on this special occasion, as we celebrate 25 years of God's faithfulness, I thought the best thing would be to go back and revisit that ministry philosophy that has carried us through these years. But I'm not going to preach from our written philosophy or purpose statement. Instead, I'm going to go to the Word of God, because that's where those principles come from. In fact, what you have really in the pastoral epistles is a biblical ministry philosophy. We had determined from the very first day of this church that we wanted to base everything we do on God's word. And when it comes to the church, we don't have to reinvent the wheel. We don't need to, in fact, should not come up with our own ideas and methods. God has told us in his word what he wants us to be and do. And so our goal has always been to line up with his word. And again, we have not been perfect in this, to say the least. We have failed many, many times, but it is this commitment to God's word, first and foremost, that I believe the Lord has blessed, and this has carried us to the place where we are today. And it's with this in mind that we approach our text from 2 Timothy 4 this morning. I believe we could not go to a better text on this particular day. In fact, if you study 1 and 2 Timothy, you find this philosophy of ministry here. These are principles that are not just good ideas, they are really the essence of what God desires for his church. If we're going to do church God's way, we have to follow these principles. Now, you could really go through these two books and you could make a list of all the things that Paul instructs here, but we can really boil it down to five main goals. Five goals. He's giving these to young Timothy, whom he has mentored and is now entrusting to his care, the church at Ephesus. These are the five main areas. Number one, be faithful to preach the word of God. Number two, be bold in exposing error and false teaching. Number three, set an example of godly living. Number four, work hard and be diligent in ministry. And number five, be ready to suffer hardship. Now, we're going to spend more on that last one in a moment. But the first thing I want you to know about these statements of purpose is that they're really the exact opposite of the direction most of the evangelical church today is going. Parker Bible Church started from my own experience with the pragmatic seeker church movement. And God taught me the hard way, this is not his plan for the church. Now, I know a lot has happened in the last 25 years in the evangelical church. I know the seeds of that movement really are still with us, have really never gone away. It really is still impacting the way many people approach ministry even today. The writer of Ecclesiastes said, there's really nothing new under the sun. It's all the same. It just gets recycled. And church history shows that we've had to fight the same fights over and over again, each time with maybe just a new little twist, but essentially the same thing. For example, Charles Spurgeon spent the last 4 years of his life battling against the early stages of modernism. And his fight against this cancer in the church was called the downgrade controversy. It was called that because of an article that appeared in his Sword and the Trowel magazine. And in that article, Spurgeon explained that once you start down the path to theological liberalism, it is like a slippery slope. And you usually find yourself all the way down the hill. He called this the downgrade. And his argument was that momentum takes over until you eventually have totally forsaken the truth. And interestingly, the Baptist Union that he was part of kicked him out over this controversy. And then later, after he died, they erected a statue to him. Spurgeon's church was by far the largest church in the Baptist Union, but they didn't like him taking this kind of stand for the truth. But another important point about this is that modernism was not used at first to refer to theology, but to methodology. It had to do with methodology. The methodology of the church was changed to try to show the world that we're modern. That was the whole thing. And the idea was, we want to reach modern man, so we need to adapt our methods in order to do that. And the early modernists were not out to change the church's theology. They were seeking to simply make Christianity more palatable to a cynical world. And I hope that sounds familiar to you, because it is exactly the same thing the church growth gurus of the 1980s were saying. That is exactly what has led to the modern pragmatic church movement that is still very prominent today. But here's the problem with changing the methodology. It always ends up changing theology. It always does. You know, the cry of the seeker church advocate was, well, we're not changing our doctrine, we're just changing our methods. That sounds good, and a lot of people have bought into that, but it never works that way. Changing methods always ends up changing theology. It did in Charles Spurgeon's day. It has in our day as well. Now, as you know, I could go into this big diatribe about the seeker-sensitive church, but you already know what I'm talking about. This pragmatic, market-sensitive philosophy of ministry really has led to such things as preaching that never mentions anything negative like sin or judgment. It has led to preaching that only focuses on felt needs and popular psychological principles. It has led to music that is essentially a form of entertainment, along with devotional speakers that are really stand-up comics or self-help gurus. John MacArthur has said this approach is good at capturing people's attention and affections, but not really good at capturing their hearts for God. And I could spend the whole time today talking about the pitfalls of this ministry philosophy, but what I want to do with the remaining time that we have this morning is to focus on God's blueprint for the church. In many ways, it is the exact opposite of what most are doing today. Now, we read our text just a few minutes ago, but it is obvious from that passage of Scripture that Paul had no room for a give the people what they want philosophy of ministry. In fact, it is quite the opposite of that. He did not send Timothy out to do a survey of people's felt needs or call on him to use the latest technology to show video clips of the most popular movies of that day. He did not appeal to worldly techniques for achieving success. In fact, the admonition that he gave him really had nothing at all to do with how people would respond to the message. What he had to say had nothing to do with external criteria such as affluence, numbers, popularity, or influence. No, it had to do with biblical, spiritual success. Things like godliness, discipleship, faithfulness, spiritual commitment, and truth. So let's dive into this text for just a few moments. And the first thing we see here is the calling. The calling. Look with me again at 2 Timothy 4:1. I solemnly charge you in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who is to judge the living and the dead, and by his appearing and his kingdom, preach the word. Preach the word. There's only one command here. That's to preach the word of God. There's only one priority. And Timothy is to do that faithfully in light of the fact that he will have to give an account to the Lord Jesus Christ. Preachers must always remember that our accountability is to God and not to men. And what kind of ministry pleases God? The faithful proclamation of his word. That must be the centerpiece of any biblical ministry philosophy. Everything else really flows from that priority. And listen, sticking with that priority is not easy. The message that we are required to proclaim is often difficult and offensive. Many themes of Scripture are not popular in the world today, even among evangelical Christians. The Bible even says that Christ himself is a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense. Even the message of the cross is a stumbling block to many and foolishness to others. Paul said, a natural man does not accept the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him, and he cannot understand them because they are spiritually appraised. Now, we don't expect unbelievers to respond positively to the principles of God's word because they cannot understand spiritual truth. But even believers often resist certain aspects of God's truth. Many don't want to hear about sin and judgment. Some don't want to consider taking up a cross to follow Christ. And often in the church, there is a call to soften the message and take out all the negative aspects of biblical teaching. Often there is pressure on pastors to avoid certain biblical themes and keep everything positive and light. But listen, folks, no faithful preacher can do that. We must preach the full counsel of God, whether it is popular or not. If we don't, we're not being faithful to our mandate from God. Now, what word was Timothy to preach? Well, Paul had identified it in the previous chapter. In chapter 3, verse 16, he said, all Scripture is inspired by God and is profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be adequate, equipped for every good work. It's obvious he's talking about God's word here. He said in Acts chapter 20, I have not failed to declare to you the whole counsel of God. He told the Corinthians, when I came to you, I did not come with superiority of speech or of wisdom, proclaiming to you the testimony of God. For I determined to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. In other words, he's saying this. He's saying, I didn't come to entertain you with jokes and stand-up comedy. I did not come to give you some sort of pop psychology or positive devotional thoughts. I didn't come to you with some kind of lofty rhetoric or novel insights. I came with the clear truth of the gospel. I came with the clear testimony of God's word. This is what we must give. We must faithfully proclaim the word of God, every part of it, and we must do it in a clear and systematic way. That's why we have been committed to expository preaching from the very beginning of this church. This is our mandate. This is the calling of every faithful preacher. But secondly, we have the connotations. Look at verse 2 again. Preach the word, be ready in season and out of season, reprove, rebuke, exhort with great patience and instruction. What a critical word this is. Timothy really is called to a never-ending task, and so is every faithful preacher today. He is to preach the word regardless of the climate, regardless of the reception of it. It doesn't matter if people are favorable or unfavorable toward it. It doesn't matter if it's popular or not. It doesn't matter if it is in line with the popular opinions of men or not. He is to faithfully proclaim the word of God without regarding any of that. You know, sometimes the word of God is in season. Sometimes people want to hear God's truth and they're eager to learn it. But other times it is out of season and they don't want to hear it. And listen, the market-driven philosophy of the seeker church movement has created really an atmosphere where evangelical Christians today no longer want to hear the systematic exposition of God's word. Many evangelical Christians today no longer have an appetite for that. They can't sit for 45 minutes and listen to the clear exposition of a text of Scripture. They don't want that anymore. So what do? Do we dumb down the message? Should we shorten our sermons down to a 15 to 20 minute devotional? Should we conclude that biblical preaching is outmoded and resort to showing video clips of popular movies? No, we cannot do that. We must not do that. Paul says the faithful preacher will continue to preach God's word even when it is no longer fashionable, even when it's not popular. When that is the case, really, we must redouble our efforts to proclaim God's word because that gives indication of the spiritual weakness of the church. And notice what Paul says about the tone of the preaching. Sometimes people are critical of a preacher's tone, but it's interesting to see what Paul has to say here. He uses three words that describe the preacher's tone. And two of the three are negative. The first two, reprove and rebuke, have negative connotations. But if a preacher fails to reprove and rebuke, he has failed in his calling. And he's to do this with great patience. He's to do this over and over again with much instruction. This is really a never-ending task, and it takes a lot of patience and continual instruction. Listen, you can't preach an expository sermon in 15 minutes. You can't do it. It takes at least 45 minutes to explain what a text says and what it means and how it applies to our lives today. This is the task of every faithful preacher of God's word. Oh, but then we see the compromise. Verse 3, for the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but wanting to have their ears tickled, they will accumulate for themselves teachers in accordance to their own desires. Paul says there's going to come a time when Christians will no longer endure sound doctrine. When will that time be? Well, in the previous chapter, he said, in the last days, difficult times will come. In 1 Timothy 4:1, he said, the Spirit explicitly says that in later times, some will fall away from the faith, paying attention to deceitful spirits and doctrines of demons. So putting these thoughts together, Paul says there's going to be a time at the end of the age when difficult times will come and many will fall away from the faith and they will not endure sound doctrine anymore. Is it possible we have arrived at that time? You know, when I hear all these evangelical pastors saying things like, expository preaching is dead, People don't want to hear that anymore. It makes me wonder if we have arrived at the time Paul was referring to. But what I want you to see is these are not words of wise and great insight here. They are words of compromise Paul said would ultimately come. You know, when Haddon Robinson, who was once the greatest advocate of expository preaching, comes to the conclusion that it can no longer be utilized today, he's voicing this very truth. Paul said it's coming, and surely it has. So what do we do? What do we do? Do we acquiesce? Do we replace the preaching of God's word with something else? Of course not. We redouble our efforts. We preach it with greater passion than ever before. MacArthur says, when people will not tolerate the truth, that's when courageous, outspoken preachers are most desperately needed to speak it. That's when bold, faithful preaching of God's word is needed the most. And by the way, how is it that people get to the place where they no longer endure sound doctrine? How does that happen? What leads people to come to that place where they won't sit under expository preaching anymore? Ultimately, it is because they love their sin. Sound preaching confronts sin, and many get to the place where they will no longer tolerate that. They just want to have their ears tickled. They just want to listen to someone who will tell them how great they are and give them what they want to hear. In fact, the Bible says they will accumulate for themselves this kind of teacher. There'll come a time when faithful preachers of God's word will be out of a job because no one will go and listen to them anymore. And so-called churches will be led by false teachers that are just giving the latest popular message. And the people will get to the place where they no longer tolerate the preaching of God's truth. Why? Because they have become corrupted by the world. And they will get to the place where they will only listen to those who make them feel good. And they will only listen to those who are always positive and never confront their sin. But there's a great price to be paid for that. And that leads us fourthly to the consequence. The consequence. Look with me at verse 4. And they will turn away their ears from the truth, and they will turn aside to myths. As a result of this, they will no longer know the truth. They will be totally deceived. They will embrace lies, things that are nothing but myths. They will become victims of their own refusal to hear the truth. They will embrace a false gospel that will ultimately condemn their own souls. Listen, when you turn away from God's truth, all you are left with is that which is false. And all you're left with is that which will not save and will not sanctify. And the sad thing is, this is exactly where the evangelical church is today. Evangelical Christianity has lost its appetite for solid biblical preaching and is therefore flirting with serious doctrinal error. As one pastor put it, the church is throwing its arms open wide and embracing every kind of aberrant viewpoint. Christians are madly pursuing new revelation in the forms of prophecies and dreams. Preachers are denying the existence of hell. The modern gospel is promising heaven without holiness. Churches are ignoring the biblical teaching on women's roles, homosexuality, and other issues that are politically charged. Compromise in the church. What must be our response? Well, Paul gives it to us in verse 5. So the last thing we see here is the consistency. Look at verse 5. But you, be sober in all things, endure hardship, do the work of an evangelist, fulfill your ministry. Now, the idea of being sober here means to understand your priorities. It means to be steady and attentive. It has nothing at all to do with alcohol, and it does not mean to be gloomy or boring. It means to be fully in control and to be consistent day in, day out, week in, week out. Just be consistent. In connection with preaching, this is referring to a solid, stable person, a preacher who's not chasing after the latest trend or fad. And this is so important. In the face of a changing world, in light of a vacillating church, in the context of a rocking and reeling society, here is one who is rooted and steadfast in the proclamation of God's truth. Listen, we've had enough of erratic, trendy, whimsical preachers who craft their sermons after the desires of the masses. What is needed are those who are solid and steady and are fully committed to the proclamation of the unchanging truth of God. Now, I'm not going to spend time on all those terms in verse 5, but I do think it is significant that Paul told Timothy to endure hardship. Endure hardship. He doesn't say, you'll have a big church, everything will always go smoothly, you won't ever have any problems. No, he said, expect tough times. Expect tough times. Faithful preachers are not those who yearn for the applause of men. They're those who yearn to hear the master say, well done, good and faithful servant. And what Paul is saying here is really, those who are faithful to give God's word, no matter what, are going to face opposition. They're going to be criticized. They're going to be rejected by many. Faithfulness and hardship always go hand in hand. In fact, Paul also told Timothy, suffer hardship with me as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. You want to be a good soldier of Christ? You got to be ready to suffer hardship. It comes with the territory. I'll close with this. John Stott once said, there are many popular preachers today, but not many powerful preachers. He's right. There are many who can gather a crowd because they are gifted orators, interesting storytellers. There are many who have dynamic personalities and arousing speech makers. But no one is powerful who does not preach God's word. It is only God's word that has the power to change lives. And no faithful preacher will ever water down the truth or avoid certain themes just because they're not popular. Being popular does not mean being pleasing to the Lord. So with all this in mind, I propose a change to our philosophy of ministry for the next 25 years. I propose that we write it in stone and that we pursue it with greater passion than ever before. Let's pray. Father, we pray this morning you would help us to have your priorities. This is your church. You are the Lord of your church. Help us as your shepherds, help us as your servants just to be faithful to you. You are always faithful to us. And Lord, you have given us salvation when we don't deserve it. You have provided it by sending your only begotten Son into the world to die on a cruel cross so that we might have atonement and forgiveness for sin. And Lord, we thank you that we have everlasting life because of Jesus Christ. And Lord, we thank you that we have your word. Help us to give it faithfully, week in and week out. And Lord, that we'll never waver from those priorities. We thank you for your church. What a joy and blessing it is. And Lord, we thank you that we can be part of it by your grace. So Lord, as we now consider all that you have done in this place, and as we now turn our hearts toward remembering and celebrating your goodness, help us to continue to worship you alone. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, we are going to sing once again and then move to some of that celebration and look forward to that. So let's stand together for just a moment and let's sing, "The Lord is my salvation." Because indeed, that is where our hope lies, is in the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's sing together.
The grace of God has reached for me and pulled me from the raging sea. And I am safe on this solid ground. The Lord is my salvation. I will not fear when darkness falls. His strength will help me scale these walls. I'll see the dawn of the rising sun. The Lord is my salvation. Who is like the Lord our God, strong to save, faithful in love? My debt is paid and the victory won. The Lord is my salvation. Hidden in the Lord. He flowers each promise of his word. When winter fades, I know spring will come. The Lord is my salvation. In times of waiting, times of need, when I know long, when I am weak, I know his grace will renew these days. The Lord is my salvation. Who is like the Lord our God, strong to save, faithful in love? My debt is paid and the victory won. The Lord is my salvation. And when I reach the final day, he will not leave me in the grave, but I will rise, he will call me home. The Lord is my salvation. God the Son, glory be
Amen. Please be seated once again and enjoy this 25th anniversary video.
At Riverside Baptist Church in Denver to pray and plan for the launch of Riverside Baptist Church South. Finally, the big day came and the new church was born. The first official service was held at Cherokee Trail Elementary School on September 11th of that year. The rest, as they say, is history. In 1995, the Lord used a Christian woman named Marion Wood to provide 10 acres of property for the growing church. The land was made available at an amazing price, and in the Lord's grace, was paid off within 1 year. Mrs. Wood even donated a portion back toward its purchase. Near the end of 1997, it became obvious we had outgrown the facilities at Cherokee Trail. The Lord moved again in His providence, and we were able to move to the much larger Chaparral High School. Near the end of 1999 and on into 2000, we began construction of the first phase of a five-phase master plan. The first phase provided 14,000 square feet of space and cost $3.2 million. It is the building we still call home today.
How firm our foundation. The soul that is trusting in Jesus as Lord will press on enduring.
In 2017, the church added the North Wing to our facilities. This allowed us to move our church offices close to the main building and increase the number of classrooms. The work was done primarily by volunteers and cost around $340,000. The Lord has been very gracious to us.
Does that bring memories? So good to see some of these families that were with us, right, from the very first. What a great time. It's my privilege to be able to verbally tell you some of the little backstories that were going on in these early days. What an incredible thing to witness. Pastor quoted Psalm 127:1, unless the Lord builds the house, they that labor in vain. And we know the house is not just a structure. It is the church. It is the spiritual body of Christ, where those that love the Lord and love his word come together, share our gifts, and share fellowship one with another, learn to love each other more and love him. What a powerful thing it has been to witness from the very beginning. As the Youngblood family and the Pipkin family, and there were five total families that were a part of that very first time in 1994. We left that previous church because expository preaching was not done, and that people looked at the obedience of Scripture in a very cavalier way. And so there were these families, and we stayed together as families. We started attending Riverside Baptist Church in the central location near Mile High Stadium. And we were attending there on Sunday mornings, and Pastor Kirk and Julie, they were out of the pastorate that time, and that pastor, Pastor Rick Ferguson, befriended Pastor Kirk, and we learned about the Arms Around Denver program, which was Riverside Central's church planting ministry, and that ended up being a tremendous ministry. As we look back, they planted around 25 some odd churches. And so Pastor Rick talked to Pastor Kirk about the fact that, you know, there were a number of people from the Parker area going all the way to Riverside Central. And from Parker and from Elbert County and from Elizabeth and so on. And so he asked Pastor Kirk if that would be a possible mission field and a church plant that he might consider. Pastor said he would consider that and pray over it. So Pastor Kirk asked for a meeting of those families. And so we met in the Youngblood home in Aurora. I'll never forget, he said, right at the end, he said, you know, if we do this, it'll be a lot of work, but it'll be a lot of blessing. And man, was he right. As we look back on 25 years, wow. So that was the beginning of Riverside Baptist Church South. So those few families, we were meeting again on Sunday mornings at Riverside Central, and we were allowed to use the wonderful little chapel of Riverside Central, beautiful little facility, and we had that all to ourselves on Sunday evening. Pastor did some teaching, great time of fellowship, but we met every week. We prayed, and on Wednesdays we would always be faithful to meet in one of our homes, praying that the Lord would provide, the Lord would show us the right things to do to start a church. Who are we to be able to do that? But you know, the Lord provided each and every step of the way. And Riverside, the main church, offered more encouragement than anything else, and offered advice and encouragement. What a blessing that was. So we prepared that whole summer. And we, there was much to do. We needed to find a place for our first service. So where was that going to be? So we found Cherokee Trail Elementary School. We submitted our application, but you know, we didn't just get it. We had to wait on a few names to come off of the list. So we waited. It was eventually provided. We had a place to meet. And we needed to get the word out. We were preparing the whole time and praying the whole time. But we needed to be able to have the ability to get the word out with brochures and information out to several different zip codes in the area. Well, we needed a bulk mailing permit. It doesn't sound like much, but that was a big deal. Because, you know, first class postage to several zip codes and just a few families, there was no way we could unless we had that permit. So we had submitted the permit, and we waited. Weeks went into a month or so. We were beginning to worry and can be concerned that we would have to move the date. It was like 2 days or so before the deadline that we said that had to be in our hands, Pastor got the permit. Praise God. We had a place. We were able to get the word out. We could finish printing the brochures, and we sent those to the zip codes. In the meantime, we had used the Riverside Central's phone bank. They had a whole room of phones. We got on those phones, and we talked to all the contacts that were given to us from Riverside, from the area. Great conversations. And Pastor and visited many, and several of us did. What a wonderful time that was to let the people know in the area that we were about to start a new church. So that day came, September 11th, 1994. I'll never forget. We got there. We'd been preparing, picking up all the nursery stuff and the soundboard and getting that all ready to go. And what was also very fascinating and very interesting is that he provided all of the needed gifts of people that were necessary. Bill Yannis led the music. Susan was on the piano. We had teachers to teach our various Sunday school classes. Of course, Pastor Kirk led the way. What an awesome thing. Just a few, but we had all we needed to start. So that first day came. We got there early. We set everything up. We checked the sound system several times and got rid of the pops. And, you know, in those days, it was, you had to get there early to set up all the chairs, and everything had to be completely set up. It was just a gym floor. So we were there. We had everything ready to go. Half hour before, there was no one there new. 15 minutes, no one there new. You know, no one had arrived yet. 10 minutes before, no one had arrived. well, we're going to have a great service. We're going to listen to Pastor, and it's going to be awesome. But no one was there. 5 minutes before, no one had shown. And then, I never forget, they had this glass entry. Looking out, hey, there's a car. It's turning in. Wow, someone's coming. Car after car after car came immediately right behind them. We had 119 people the very first day. Praise the Lord. So that was the kickoff of Riverside Baptist Church South. Pastor Kirk was faithful at expository teaching, and people were listening and wanting the word and craving for it. That's where the motto, where people are excited about Jesus and excited about God's word, that's where it came from, because we were. And we grew. We were in Cherokee Trail almost 3 years, but very quickly we knew that we needed to find land and we needed to find another place to be. So we were looking for another facility. We had outgrown that little gym floor. And we were looking for a place that could allow us to expand in our Sunday morning service and also allow us to have evening service and possibly Awanas. We needed those things badly. So we found Chaparral High School. So Pastor filled out the application, turned it in. Again, there was a number of names ahead of us. We didn't just walk in there and get that. So we started praying. So our prayers were that God would provide this. This seemed like a perfect place for us to be. It took some time. But one at a time, those names started dropping off the list. Pastor got the call. Chaparral High School is yours. So Sunday mornings, we had theater seating, a stage, piano. We were able to meet on Sunday evenings. We could have Awana. And for some of us that were lugging all that stuff around, we were able to build a couple of storage boxes and fill them full of our stuff and pack them into the back corners of the high school. We didn't have to haul them into and out of our vehicles to have service. What a great thing that was. So we grew. It was a great time of fellowship and learning and focus on the Lord and what he was doing among us. So we had that place. And even before we actually moved into Chaparral, we were looking for land. We had a building committee, and we were really earnest about going out there and finding the right piece of land for us. But we would look, and we would look, and things that were acceptable were way out of our price range. Even in that day, can you imagine what they'd be now? And so we were, I'll never forget, Jenna Irvin, very experienced in real estate and so on, she was on our committee. And we were about ready to look at a piece of property that down here at Main Street and Jordan onto the east towards the drainage there. And it had quite a drainage area in it. And she said to the committee, well, so we're going to buy the whole. It's all that needed to be said. We stopped right there. We need to get to our knees and we need to start praying. Because this is not what the Lord wants us to do or the place that we need to be. It wasn't very long after that. Pastor was talking to another like-minded pastor in Parker area. And this pastor told him about Marion Woods, a widow lady that had recently lost her husband in the line of duty, the only firefighter to lose his life in Parker up until that time. And she was out here on this very property in that little house to the north and was really wanting to get back to her family in Texas as things were just not the same. And so Pastor and one of our committee members went to meet with her. And they explained what was going on with Riverside Baptist Church South, and that we would really like to see if we could buy this property. Would she be willing to sell? She didn't answer immediately, but she got back to them fairly quickly. She said, I would love to sell my land for your Baptist church to be put here. We would honor her and honor her husband. What a blessing that was. She not only agreed to sell, she negotiated a fair price and then later donated a portion to us. What incredible provision. Things like that don't just happen. So we had land. We were able to then start the process of finding an architect, a builder, the engineers, and get started in the development of this. But before that, we were blessed that within the first year, we had several tent meetings and so on, and they were great spirit-filled times of giving and a blessed fellowship. And we were sacrificially giving. And that blessing of that was that we were able to have the land paid off before 1 year. And you might have seen some of the pictures of them burning the warranty deed, the instrument of debt that we sign when we get a loan. That document was burned within the first year. So we owned the land. Praise the Lord. So as we were looking at the building, you know, the architect did his thing, and what a beautiful structure we have. We've been so blessed with this building. And we had, the civil engineer had some real challenges on this property. You know, we didn't have gas nearby. We'd had to spend $100,000 plus to bring it up Main Street. So we just said, okay, we're going to use propane for the duration till the neighborhood brings gas to us. And we did until just 2 years ago. We were on propane. Water was available. We popped the main there in Main Street and brought it in with a hydrant, and not a problem. Power was here. Sewer was a real problem. It was a long way away. Way down Main Street, it had cost us a couple hundred thousand plus just to bring sewer line. Could have delayed our project here on this church building for a long time. So we were praying. We gave it to the Lord. We had a civil engineer who was very sharp and who started looking at the options and the alternatives. He noticed there was a sewer stub coming out of the west side of Bradbury Farms, which is the property, the project just to the east of Carousel Farms. You know, we were out here with the prairie dogs and the horse farm, and what a blessing that was. But he was looking at where that stub was, okay? And it happened to be right between two 20-acre parcels as they laid end-to-end, north and south. And he examined the title work on the south property. And he found that title work on the south property was 50 feet short of where the tax parcel said it should be. What? Things like that don't just happen. Those are serious mistakes, real problematic. Several attorneys took a look. Title company, hey, you titled this. What's the problem? They confirmed the error. That meant that the existing people that owned Carousel Farms didn't own a 50-foot strip of land across the whole length of Carousel Farms. We immediately said, okay, who does? We found a elderly gentleman and retired in Florida who was thrilled to find out he was going to get a little money for something he didn't even own. Praise the Lord. We were able to buy a 50-foot piece of property across the whole length of Carousel Farms, exactly where the stub was coming out of Bradbury Farms, and hook into and touch the north end of our property. Praise God. That's where this came from, all the way from the very beginning. So we had all of our utilities. We had this building ready to go. You know, the Lord blessed us with also having the criteria financially to be able to secure a loan for that sizable a debt. We weren't huge at that point, but God provided. He provided financing for us, and we were able to button that up in late 99 and build in year 2000, so that we opened this building in January of 2001. What a great blessing that was, and still is. This building has been used in a great, great way. We have been able to use it during weekday evenings, Awanas. We have been able to even offer it to some community events, which have been a great blessing even to the community. So from 2001 till now, we have experienced our growth, but we've also experienced some real testing. You know, we changed from congregational rule to eldership rule, and there were some challenges with that later on. And you know, the Lord has provided along the way, and we lost some people as a result of that. And with that, we had some real challenges with our financing. And there was a time or so, a period there, that we wondered if we would even be able to hold the mortgage and pay that. But God was faithful, and He delivered. In spite of anything we were doing, He was going to see that this place would stay and would stand for the truth and would stay steadfast in the expository teaching of God's word and the love for each other and the love for Christ. What an incredible witness that was. And we also have had and gone through many trials of faith. We've lost many loved ones, some of our elderly and others. Our hearts hurt for that, but we went through those trials. We also, and some of those were even with our youth. We lost John Tomlin to Columbine and Kobe Stevens to suicide. You know, we've gone through many trials, but God has been faithful, and He's delivered us. We have been blessed in this fellowship with many wonderful holy weddings. We have seen God's ministry and His working in the lives of our people, strengthening them. Our men and women's ministries are strong and growing stronger and growing all the time. Our children's church and our children's education wing is full and growing and continuing to grow. We're really blessed there. And we have strong teaching in our Sunday school, adult Sunday schools especially, with several things going on. And it is so encouraging to see our vibrant young families and their little ones. What a precious thing that is to see. And we are ever growing in that area. We have nothing but praise and honor and glory to offer to our Lord and Savior for all He has done for these 25 years. And I pray that He will and be faithful to us, and we know He will. And I just pray that we are faithful to Him. To God be the glory.
Hi, Parker Bible friends. This is Ashley Dressler. Huge congratulations on the 25th anniversary of the church. What an incredible milestone that is. I wish I could be with you in person to celebrate, but know that I'm here in Tennessee celebrating in spirit, and so very grateful for the time that I was able to spend with you during my high school years. It was such a formative time of my life, and I'm so very grateful to have gotten to sit under the leadership and teaching of you, Pastor Kirk and Mr. E. Just the way that you taught with such excellence and such clarity and being so concise with the gospel. I'm grateful for that example and for my heart being led to see the truth of Jesus. And for all of you families, the Youngbloods, the Evans family, the Duties, the Kings, the way that you all loved on me and cared for me has just stayed with me my entire life, my entire journey, my faith walk. And I'm grateful for the way that you cared for me and loved on me and helped show me Jesus. And it's such a gift to get to celebrate that, to reflect on that, as I, over the last 16 years, have been able to serve in ministry with my husband, serve alongside him, to be able to look back and see the example that you family set, and especially you ladies, Mrs. Youngblood and Miss E, to think back on the example that you set of how you cared for your husbands, cared for your families, cared for those around you that God entrusted you with. It was such a gift, and I'm seeing more and more what a beautiful gift that was. And Mr. E and Ms. E, for the way that you cared for us in youth group, the fun, sweet, joyful memories that I have from that time of my life, it's a true gift. So I'm celebrating with you all. I'm so excited for you. I'm praying as you all reflect and rejoice over what God has done and what he continues to do. I just pray that the memories and the work that has been done, the ground that has been just tended to, that you all would see and enjoy and be show much gratitude and much thanks to Jesus for all that he has done. And I'm cheering you on for the next 25. Blessings.
Hi, Parker Bible, Julian Kirk. We just wanted to send a couple of words of gratitude to you all for everything that you've meant to us over the years. We've been gone a long time, 15 years. But the 7.5 to 8 years that we were there were some of the best in our lives. And most of that was due to you all's friendship and the church and everything that we were taught there and that our kids were taught. And we are just super grateful for those years that we had in Parker Bible.
Yeah, I just wanted to say how great it was and how thankful I am for just the solid teaching over those times and how much we learned while we were there. And I think we got through the book of Luke in 8 years, which was awesome. And appreciate your dedication to giving us the word by word. Just kidding. It was awesome. Also, like Cindy said, we're so thankful of the investment you and a lot of other parents invested in our kids during junior high and high school, and I blame you all mostly for how well they turned out. So thank you for that. You know, it was fun being a part of the early journey with you all and starting in the grade school and helping to build a church with you all, and that was a lot of fun.
Yep.
So,
sure was.
We appreciate your faithfulness. gratitude and faithfulness came to my mind when we were thinking about what to say. And we love you all. We miss you. We're sorry we can't be there with you this
so
time.
So sorry we can't be there this weekend.
We had a wedding we had to go to.
Yeah.
So anyway,
have
love
fun.
You all much.
Love you. Bye.
Hello, Parker Bible Church, and congratulations on 25 years of gospel ministry. My name is Kyle Lee. I was a member there from 1996 to 2001. One of the great joys of my life is to think back upon my time at this church. I formed tremendous friendships and learned so much from my time there. At Parker Bible, I began to really study God's Word. I began to pray. I began to worship and learn how to share the gospel with others. It really wasn't until I had left that I truly understood the level of impact that my time there had on my life. It was like Jesus had said in Matthew 7, 24 and 25, to build our house upon the rock, a solid foundation. I praise God that he used Parker Bible to establish in my heart the truth of God's word. It has been to me a well-placed foundation upon which I've tried to build a life of devotion to Christ. From Parker Bible, I spent time in the Marine Corps, and I've had the opportunity to serve as a youth pastor as well as an associate pastor in the Arvada, Colorado area. I now live in Bolivar, Missouri with my wife and children, where I serve as one of the elders of our church. I know that so much of my discipleship can be traced back to my time at Parker Bible, and I am so thankful. May God bless you in your future endeavors for the sake of the kingdom and to the praise of our great God, King Jesus.
Hi, everyone. Ryder King here, one of the original youth group members of what was then Riverside South Parker Bible Church. I want to say to everyone out there, happy 25th birthday. It's good to think about how faithful God has been through these years. I remember of all the days when we early on in out of Cherokee Trails Middle School, we would go and we would knock on people's doors and we would dress up in weird costumes and go to Parker Days and give away information on trying to invite people and get a chance to share the gospel with them and invite them to church and then tell them about God's word and his awesome salvation. And so I thank you that here we are 25 years later and that this church and its people are still proclaiming God's truth and proclaiming the gospel and the good news. So thank you for the impact that you've had on me and my family. I want to say thank you, Miss Julie and Pastor Kirk, for your constant presence in our lives and all that you have taught us. Miss Julie, for your teachings of grammar that are still strong with me today. And Pastor Kirk, just for teaching that love of God's word and certainly a presence that's still strong today, and I know in my life and my family's life. And so I thank you all for your work. I thank you for your faithfulness to God. And so happy birthday as a church. I hope you have a great day of celebration, and I wish I could be there. Thanks, everyone.
Time, and here I come with my Bible and pages of notes. This is not sermon number two. You did pretty good on that first one. This is just to keep me focused, just in the few minutes that I do have as I look out at all of you here. Today's overwhelming to me. I didn't know that was going to happen. I'm just thankful to see all of you here and to realize how blessed we are as a church to have you as a congregation. And I know that there's some of you that have traveled a long ways to be here. We appreciate that so much. We're just thankful for all the thoughtfulness that went into all of this. And so, Gail, thank you to Gail. For reminding us of God's faithfulness to us in all these years. That's what it's really all about, is God's faithfulness. And so we're so thankful for that. Well, it's quite a milestone, 25 years. We, Connie and I have been here in the church for 23 of the 25 years, so that's almost the whole time. And I think we have been here the whole time. We love this church, and we're thrilled to be a part of it. And when we came here those many years ago, we were looking for a church that would uphold the Bible as absolute truth and would then teach it systematically, and also help to explain the text. And we'd been listening to some guy named John MacArthur on the radio, and we had boxes of cassette tapes. That would have been a good one, John. You remember cassette tapes? we had just literally dozens of these tapes, and we listened to them constantly. And what we realized about that teaching was that we hadn't heard it anywhere that we'd been. And so we were seeking it from our heart, trying to find a church that would teach verse by verse. And we found that here at Parker Bible. And you heard Kirk's story of how he got to that place of teaching expositorially. And that's a great, just a great thing. And I don't know if you know this or not. This is just an added thought, but it's very rare to find the same pastor in the same church for 25 years or more. That's a milestone in itself. I recently saw an article that indicated that something like half of the pastors that start out for the first time in a church leave the ministry completely in less than 5 years. That's a staggering number. And of those who continue on, the average stay in a church is about 3.5 years. About 3.5 years. So I just want to take just this opportunity to personally thank Pastor and Julie for I want to thank you for your faithfulness and excellence of ministry. It's been been a wonderful time in our lives. Oh boy. Again, I didn't expect that. So it's kind of funny when that happens. Anybody ever had that happen where you couldn't speak? What happens there? I was doing okay till that happened. So what about going forward from here? When you have an anniversary, you think about the past. We think about that all the time. What about going forward? And Pastor talked about that some this morning. I think you all are aware of what's happening in society today. And it's some craziness for sure. And I think as a church, we have to understand the impact of that. But beyond that, 1 Timothy 3:15 tells us that as a church, we are to be the pillar and support of the truth. And I think, I can't help but believe that going forward from here, that we need to be even more fervently guarding the truth. We need to defend it. We need to uphold it. We need to teach it and proclaim it so that we will be a beacon of light in a lost and dying world. And interestingly, when I wrote that down on the paper, I didn't even know what you were going to say this morning. I like the part about putting it in stone. We should do that. Fervently go forward with the truth of the gospel. I think that's necessary. And there's a lot of things you could say as we go forward. I just have one other thought that I wanted to give you. And that is, I think that as a church, going forward, we need to have a passion to teach our children and our young people so that going forward in the next 25 years and even beyond that, that the testimony of God's truth will remain through those who follow. And I hope we can accomplish that. I would say, as a church, please pray for that, that God would bless our efforts as we go forward. And I'll close here just quickly. I just had one other thought that I wanted to say this morning. On behalf of the elders, for sure, I just want to thank all of you. I want to thank the church. You know, the people are the church. That's all of you that are sitting here. And I'm so thankful for all of you. Just for your loving, caring heart. It's such a pleasure to serve here in this church. And we're grateful for all of you, so thank you.
Well, we'll close with this portion this morning. If you have served this body of believers in any capacity, whether it is in the nursery, if you've taken a meal to someone, if you have helped with VBS, you have made a phone call, you have prayed for someone, if you have served in any capacity in this church, would you stand right now? Ladies and gentlemen, this is the church. Amen. All right, let me go ahead and have you be seated for just a moment. There are a few, I could mention so many, but there are a few that deserve just some special recognition, and we'll close with this part of it this morning. Because there are some who are here, and there are many who are not here today. I'm not going to mention the ones who are not here, but I just want to try to mention the ones who are in attendance today and express appreciation to them. First of all, Tim Morris led our music for 8 years in this body of believers. And you know Tim and Dana, they are worker bees. They have been rock solid for this body of believers. Let's thank Tim and Dana this morning. Secondly, in the area of music, Susan Pipkin. Susan Pipkin Susan has carried our music ministry in the last 25 years. Thank you, Susan, from the bottom of our hearts. In the area of youth, we have a couple of former youth pastors, Sam Cogburn. Is Sam, where's Sam? Sam, stand, if you would. Sam Cogburn. And John Thompson. Is John here? Is in the other building, but John Thompson. Let's thank John Thompson for his service. In the church office, Molly King, who's now Molly Sims. Where's Molly? Molly's right here. Okay, thank you, Molly. Bailey Haig, who's now Bailey Redding. Right back there. Thank you, Bailey. And then, of course, our church administrator, Rick King, the one and only, and he has served us faithfully for all these 25 years. Thank you, Rick. I want to mention some former elders, just a couple of guys. First of all, Tim Stevens, who led our church at a very critical point in the life of our church, and he provided leadership for us when we really needed it. So let's thank Tim Stevens this morning. Thank you, Tim, right back there. And then I mentioned Rick was an elder for many years, and Rick has kept us above board and, made sure that we're doing everything right financially, so we appreciate that so much. And then Matt Dwiggins, who is a current elder, but I want to mention him because this is going to be his last Sunday with us. They're moving to Nebraska. I think Jenny maybe is going to be here maybe a little bit longer, but Matt is going to be leaving. And Matt has become an excellent expositor of the Word, and this family is going to leave a big hole. But let's let them know we appreciate their service to the Lord as well. Former deacons, I just want to mention Mike Anderson. Where's Mike? Mike's right there. Mike, thank you, brother. And then Newell Nesheim. Where's Newell? Right here. Newell helped us with the website and all the graphics and all that kind of thing. Newell's helped us tremendously with that. I want to mention Jenna Irvin. Gail mentioned her, but she was very instrumental, was on the building team. She's not able to be here today, but I know is watching via live stream, so we appreciate you, Jenna, for all you did. And I want to express my appreciation to you, our appreciation to you for loving our kids. You know, our kids grew up here. It's not easy being PKs in any setting, but you have just loved our kids And you know, it's said that if you want to show love to someone, love someone that they love. And you have done that with us. You have touched our hearts in that way. And we thank you so much for loving our kids as they grew up here in this body. And then I want to say, I could not have done it without this woman here on the front row. And of course, she means so much to me. And I'm so grateful for Miss Julie. I want to thank you for a paved driveway. And that's something, you know, the elders came to me and said, Pastor, you've been here 25 years. You know, we want to do something special for you. What would you like? You know, you want a trip around the world? And, you know, we could have done something, a trip or, you know, sabbatical or whatever. And we said, you know what we'd really like? We'd like a paved driveway. And so you guys did that for us. And just like the church, we wanted something that's going to be lasting. That's going to be there, you know, years down the road. So thank you for that. And you've already heard about going forward. Denny challenged us with that. I thank our current staff, Michael Jackson, John Hedberg, Cale Forrington in the church office, and, of course, Rick King. And we could not do without. God has done a special thing in bringing our staff together. And I'm looking forward to many years with them. Thank you for being here this morning. I'm going to give just some quick instructions, and then I'm going to let you go. We want everyone to be in the picture. So the first thing we're going to do when we dismiss in just a moment is we're going to go out on the west side of the building over here, and we're going to take a picture of everyone, and we want everybody to be in the picture. So don't leave. We want everyone to go do that, and then that will be followed by our meal. Our meal will be in the tent, so you can, after we've taken the picture, you can head over to the tent for the meal, and we would encourage you to allow our guests and our older adults to go first. Let's honor them in that way and allow them to go first in line. And then remember, parents, please have your kids with you as they go through the serving line. But I hope you enjoy our great meal together. Thank you so much. Let's ask Pastor Michael to come and lead us as we sing, and we'll dismiss this morning.
Well, before we do this final song, we had to have one more video that you need to see.
Hey, Parker Bible Church. This is Johanna Johnston. Most of you probably remember me as Johanna Youngblood. I am Pastor Kirk and Julie's youngest daughter, and I am sending you guys a video message from Italy. My husband Matt and I are serving here in Italy as church planners. We have three children, Alice, Noelle, and Robbie, and we so wish we could be with you today, but I just wanted to take a minute to send you a few of my reflections on Parker Bible Church celebrating 25 years. And I can remember vividly the initial days of Parker Bible Church and the getting there early, leaving late, the setup, the tear down. I could remember they entrusted me with the job of taking the signs around to put on all of the nursery rooms. I can remember watching the ladies set up the coffee and the guys in the gymnasium setting up the chairs and the sound equipment. And I can also remember watching out the front window of Cherokee Trail, just filled with excitement at who might come that day. And it was such a sweet, really precious season of church life as we watched the Lord add different families. We got to see baptisms, new conversions, and we just began to have such a vibrant body life. And as I think about it, I realize that the profound impact that that had on my life, and it was such a season of preparation for what the Lord would have for me here in Italy. And as I reflect on the years that seemed to fly by, that were so full, I can't help but think of all of the different people that the Lord brought into our lives over the years. And I'm so thankful. That was such a protection in my life as a young lady. I can think about all of the different women who poured into my life, the different Sunday school teachers who faithfully taught, the youth workers. And as I think about it, I realize that that was such a privilege to see faith lived out by so many different people. It was such an example for me, and again, had such an impact on my life. And as we are in the beginning stages of church ministry here, we're now doing the setup and the tear down and the getting there early and the anxious watching and waiting to see who the Lord will bring. And it's really precious to think about the fact that what is happening here in Italy is an extension of what the Lord has done there at Parker Bible Church. And of course, I can't send this video without saying something to my daddy. So, Dad, I just want you to know how thankful I am for you and for 25 years of service to the Lord. And sorry, the older I get, the more I realize that enduring over the long haul is such a precious gift of the Lord's sustaining grace. And I'm thankful for you and Mom and for your example to Matt and me. And we long to follow in your footsteps, the footsteps of faithfulness. And there's been trials, there's been times of discouragement, and yet the Lord has kept you guys faithful. And I just want to say thank you. Thank you for remaining faithful. I've seen you guys grow in the Lord, but I've also seen you remain unchanged in your desire to stay faithful to the Lord and His Word. So I love you. I'm thankful for you. And to all of you at Parker Bible Church, I'm sending so much love in the Lord. I pray that this is a joyous celebration today.
Amen. Well, let's stand together as we praise and give glory to God this morning.
Come praise and glorify our God, the Father of our Lord. In Christ He has in heavenly realms His blessings on us poured. For pure and blameless in His sight He destined us to be. And now we've been adopted through His Son eternally. To the praise of your glory, to the praise of your mercy and grace, to the praise of your glory, you are the God who saves. Come praise and glorify our God.
Come praise and glorify our God, for we believe the word. And through our faith we have a seal, the Spirit of the Lord. The Spirit guarantees our hope until redemption's done, until we join in endless praise.
Joy it is to have each and every one of you here today. If you would, please make your way out towards the west end there, and we'll do a picture, and then it is time for lunch. And so enjoy and enjoy the fellowship with one another. Please make your way out if you would. You're dismissed.
Rage against the captors, and with the sword